Eagle County, past the lagoons, you get to Oceanside, you hang a right and you go up a river, and you go across the river, through Duluth Canyon, then ultimately through Temecula Gorge. And you get to Temecula, and you get off, and you stretch your legs a little bit, look around, and then you sound a little hungry. You go, well, I want a chicken sandwich. So they wire ahead to Fallbrook, and they prepare a chicken sandwich for you, and they bring it down into the canyon. This is actually made this myself. This is the original roof. They would wire back to Fallbrook, and they would bring you food down in the canyon for your return trip.
What year?
This would have been the 1880s. 1880s. They didn't operate that long, probably in 10 years. And most of them had a lot of problems getting washed out. But can you imagine what a wonderful trip that would be? I mean, the one-day trip, you could see all this stuff. It's, you know, like an exciting e-ride, you know, at Disneyland. And these trains had a lot of people. I mean, it looked like 300 people. In San Diego, you had that many people in those days. So a good portion of San Diego's population was probably on that train. That's really not what I'm supposed to be talking about, but I get inspired. Think about that thought. And the other inspirational thing to me is like, you know, what Beth was alluding to, you know, if you look around that hill, there's a 250,000 people over there. Look over that hill, there's another 40,000 people over there. And here we are in this beautiful, pristine location, and it's critical to hang on to something like this. So that's not what I'm supposed to be talking about. I'm here today to talk about the railroad that actually came into Fallbrook, not the one that went through the canyon. And here's proof.
This is proof that's a railroad train.
Here's Fallbrook. You get our iconic. Actually, I can point to this one. This is the old station we had here. This picture was probably taken in the late 1950s, early 1960s. Mm-hmm. This would have been an excursion train that came down from Los Angeles, mm-hmm. or up from San Diego, for one of our, we had Pioneer Days, we called it. It was a festival we had here. And they would come into town, and people would come into town, go to a barbecue. Hundreds of people would come. There would be a parade, maybe that kind of stuff. Maybe an early avocado festival. Interestingly enough, also, passenger train service was discontinued on a regular basis in 1942, so this was a special circumstance. But it was everybody that was around those days remembered. So now I'll get into what I'm supposed to be talking about. It's the railroad in Fallbrook from 1916 to 1971. I'm learning how to use this. There we go. So the scope of the discussion today is to talk about rain and destruction in 1916. A new alignment into Fallbrook, recovery of equipment that was left marooned down in the canyon from the old, this is the old route, this is the old Fallbrook station down here. They had a big flood and a lot of equipment was marooned and couldn't get it out, couldn't go either way. Arrival in downtown Fallbrook, a little about the businesses served, ultimately the decline in usage, the destruction of our beautiful depot, last days of operation, and then there is hope again, the turn of the caboose. That's going to be a big deal. Okay, here we go. Rain and destruction. Anybody follows the annals of rain in Southern California, 1916 was a critical year. There was flooding everywhere. And we had Fallbrook Station down here in the canyon, and it was just devastated. It was literally washed away, except for a few remaining items like the engine, some of the cars, a turntable, and a few other things. We had 19 inches of rain. 1 month, basically, two storms in Fallbrook. And it could have been more in the canyon. It very well could have been more. But the canyon had a history of being prone to flooding, and this kind of was the straw that broke the camel's back. It just was not a good alignment, a good place to have a railway. The riverbed was scoured down some places 25 feet below its former level. There was debris found on the ocean, 50 miles away. It actually scoured to the point where it revealed Native American grinding stones, that sort of thing. There was a few things for him, and we'll be looking at those shortly. But what we're going to move on to now is this is Fallbrook station as it existed down here in there was, we think, a post office there and a ticketing station, that sort of thing. But it wasn't a big depot, you might think of later. There was a community that was in this area that mostly was made up of people that worked on the train. But there was a little community there, a post office, a little store. As you can see, some of the cars parked there and the sidings and stuff. And this is the room screen. I'll show you pretty much the same area after the flood. That's after the flood. And you can see not much left. It's devastating. The railroad was not built up very high in this area above the river, so it was prone to problems a lot, but this really, really did the trick. So you can see what happened, you know, before, after. Quite devastating. Here's an example of, now there's a weird thing that went on with this disaster. It seemed like people wanted to get their picture taken. And they got dressed up to get their picture. This gentleman here is, you know, he's pretty well dressed up and good attire. And he's come out here with his friend, and they're sitting in the bottom of this crater that was created by all this rain, you know, on the dirt, getting his picture taken. So it was something to do. I got some more of these. It just was the biggest thing going, you know, watching this rain. Here's some pictures. As you can see, it was quite devastating. There's a 721 was the number of the injured that was still in there. This car was rolled over. And you see, devastating. Now here's another interesting picture. These people came from town and went down and got on one of the trains, one of the old cars. Shortly after this, they were literally washed down in the ocean around the signals. They were washed. But it was a thing to do. And this next picture is a particular picture. This is Agnes. That's Agnes. As you can see, Agnes got dressed up. She's got her, looks like a top there, all dressed up. It says, Agnes, be careful. She came down to have her picture taken and watch the devastation. So, go figure, it was the only thing going on in town. But that's what happened. So, what are you going to do? You've lost your, this is pretty much not going to be used anymore. The old one is just completely washed out. There's debris everywhere. It's been fun. Fortunately, the Santa Fe Railway must have decided that Fall River would be still a good location for school. So they proceeded to plan and develop a new track that would come into Fall River. And it would use a portion of the old track from, say, Oceanside. If you're familiar with Camp Pendleton at all, in the old days, it was Rancho Santa Margarita. They have a ranch house there. Approximately at that location, they went to a higher grade up over a hill, and then eventually would come down to the Fall River and the new station, and they would turn it around on a thing called a WYE. I'll show you what that is over there. But people were realizing that was in this world, it was a disaster. I mean, they lost their station and stuff. And got the train to the kind of corner. That's really interesting. We needed to get our crops out, we needed to get building materials in. So having a train was a big deal. The people of Rancho Santa Margarita realized that too. They were excited about having a train actually go through the ranch. I don't know if you send their cattle in and out and do all those things anyway. So one of the things that was interesting, when they brought the new railroad, they had to move a lot of buildings existing. Moving buildings around. Everybody knew it was a good thing. So that, they were all pretty excited about that. And I'll show you how excited pretty soon. Another story that's interesting is because in 1916 all this equipment was left. The railroad would still like to bring out. They had a train, a tank car, they had cars, they had a turntable. They had significant value, so they wanted to try to get them to survive. So how are you going to get them out of there? You know, so they went out to bid. They got a bid of $40,000 from a reputable company that people thought could actually do the job. And they got a bid of $6,000 from some house movers from Pasadena. They'd never done anything like this. But their motto was, no job, too big to bid on. So they bid on it. railway always wanting to get the most bang for the buck, said, we're going to take that $6,000 bid. And they were affectionately called the boys. They were five guys, and like I said, their motto was no job too big to build on, to bid on. So there were five men, four horses, two capstans. A capstan in this case was a large winch that was driven by horses. You get these horses, they had their four horses, and they would pull it, and they would move things. And they were very ingenious bunch, though. They actually, as they moved up this hill, and it was about a mile and a half to go, it was about 450 feet in elevation change, sometimes 14% grade. They developed a system of having these chocks that would go behind the wheels as they moved it. And now, as they got to a point when they had to release the pressure, they just rest back on the chocks. They didn't want this all to go back in on the canyon. They were very ingenious, a lot of hard work, a lot of cussing. I mean, it's really fun. At the time, it was recognized as one of the greatest lifting feats ever. I don't know how you measure these things, but it was quite a thing. And the amazing part was, I mean, it was 400 tons of material. They did it in 3 months. And they got their $6,000, and they were considering themselves rich at that point. Because that's $1,200 a piece. I'm sure they had some overhead, but it was quite a story. So the boys were quite a story. I'll show you some pictures when they brought the train into town. Now, this is Main Avenue in Fallbrook. This is a bank here. This would be, Stephen Elmore. The train was stored picked up for a while there until they could get the new line in so they could reconnect it all. Here's a picture of the turntable coming up out of the canyon. As you can see, the temporary rail line they had to put in to do this. You know, they had to move it, 12% grade, very, very, very steep. And interestingly, they didn't use the turntable later. They didn't turn the train around by the use of a turntable. They used a watch. But they could salvage it, and it was probably pretty valuable other places in their railway. There's a train coming up the hill, being pulled up the hill. This gives you a little better view. This is the Blues Road, basically. Gives you a little better view of the steepness of what they were doing. This is the train, again, being stored on Main Avenue in Calder. All of these ties are not permanent, just a temporary rail here. Now, this is a pretty cool part. Arrival in downtown Fallbrook, this was a big deal. This is 1917, too. We're in World War I. The engine can now be turned around and used to the wire. I'm holding the wire for now, so you get anticipation. I will show you what it is. This is a picture of some of the people working on the train. I think this is where it crosses the Main Avenue that I can hear. It's quite a work group that came up. We've had some discussions about what direction we're looking. This is a work train. This isn't a salvage train. I thought originally we're looking westerly, but I think we're actually, I'm pretty convinced now we're looking easterly back toward where the... This is right before they connected it all together so they can make it work. The amazing thing to me is, too, from the time they had the flood in January 1916 to the time they went into business in July of 1917, they constructed this whole line, they built a new depot, built the Y, and salvaged all this equipment. In a year and a half, that was quite an effort. Yeah, but they were motivated. I'm thinking this might be some of the boys out there. The guy with the tie.